Hello. Overnight Films presents A.K.A. Blackbird. A life in bits. Written, directed, and partially narrated by James Callis. Featuring the voices of Tricia Helfer, Edward James Olmos, Mary McDonnell, Michael Trucco, Katee Sackhoff, Jamie Bamber, Aaron Douglas, Kandyse McClure, Kerry Norton-Griffith, Elizabeth Knowelden, Mark Gagliardi, London Kim, Alejandra Reynoso, Tahmoh Penikett, Alessandro Giuliani, Grace Park, Rekha Sharma, Darren Richardson, Matt Wolf, Michelle Lee, Joshua Callis, and Marc-Ivan O'Gorman. The copyright of this recording is the property of Overnight Films. All rights reserved. Thank you. Bit 1. Blackbird Origins. Testing.
Yep.
Okay. The following subject material is considered for mature audiences only and is rated R for radio play. There are scenes of graphic violence, full frontal nudity, and several scenes were recorded with the use of strobe lighting. And yeah, but because it's an audiobook, you'll have to imagine all of that. Okay? I mean, if you want to, it's up to you. Really, it's up to you. All right, Errol. Roll the tape.
No. What, do it now?
Yes, now.
Okay, right, yeah. I'll do that now, then.
Please stand by.
Hello, and welcome.
Okay, and?
We are go for liftoff in T-minus 30.
The following...
It's like a breath of fresh air.
...is a true story.
I like it.
Gosh, that's swell.
Every word of it.
Oh my goodness. Well, I didn't see that coming.
And I swear this.
All right, then.
On my life. And my name is Sonia Adams. And I am a publisher of fact-based comms.
Hit the record button.
Record.
I know the future. I know how it's going to be. I see it in my mind's eye. It turns out the future is startling me how you'd imagine it would be. How they imagined it back when. Basically, it's just us. Now. Here. Later. We've learned a lot, but intrinsically we're the same. Barring a few technical advances. We row the same, fuck the same, we eat pizza the same. Of course, it may not look exactly as you thought it might. I mean, it is the future, after all. It's inclined to go one way or another. It might be, for all you know, if you can imagine, next week, or 100 years from now, dropping through a cloud and spying below, far off in the distance, a dark coastline jarring on the horizon, and where the plateaued sea meets the rocks and the riven shore, ascending from the shadows of the breaking waves like a monstrous jaw looming into the sky at dusk. An 18th century castle. A prison fortress come military keep. A latticed gateau of woes interlaced with stones cut fathoms deep where they keep all the beasts. Built into the rocks, the tower, how like a malignant nose spiting a bear-clawed face, juts askance the ravage of jagged cliffs, glowering from the serrated edge of this devil's isle, rising in an insurgent lurch of seismic ire, overlooking a turbulent sea. You and me. Us, collectively, together at sea, are a bird. Right now, if you can believe. A big white gull swooping low over the water. I'll explain later if I get the chance. Meantime, hang on. We beat our wings majestically only every so often, as they propel us inexorably with force and grace towards the prison in the distance. As we reach the tower, we pivot our enormous wings and race upwards almost vertically, like it's meant to be, alighting at a small barred window at the top of the castle. It's our destiny. We perch on the ledge and peer through the bars.
Homme's étoile.
We chirp in disbelief at the pitiable sight that confronts our beady bird's eyes. A man in an iron mask, sitting at his desk writing with quill by taper. He raises his head and looks at us. I don't know how to describe what happens next. It's just so fabulous. Our eyes, they meet. We blink. And in the blink of our eyes, we are no longer a gull, somehow. We don't slowly transform. We have literally become a man in an iron mask. Conscious of viewing our surrounds through a kind of metal letterbox, our inky shadow playing upon the stone walls of the cell as the candlelight dances. We sit perched on a stool, hunched over our desk, holding a bundle of papers in our hands, occasionally looking to see the gull we once were, perched outside the bars on the windowsill, still looking at us, looking at it. Shush a minute.
Uh-oh. What the fuck is that?
What the fuck is going on? If only this helmet would come off. Oh, it does come off. That's a relief. Is it a game?
All units, do not remove comm helmets. Sunlight in 10, 9, 8, 7,
as the room becomes awash with light,
5,
we see the time readout in neon display. 40:59. Is that the time or the date? Whatever. Later. We replace the helmet. And suddenly, we are swimming out to sea, briskly. Our strokes are relentless, seemingly effortless. In front of us only a horizon of sea, behind us a beach receding ever farther away. We dive down under the surface of the water, going deeper and deeper and deeper. Our eyes to find ourselves, alas, descending in an iron cage surrounded by men. There's a smell in here, not the fragrance of heaven. We're suddenly very warm, penned in between them all. We catch glimpses of them now and again as light spills into and fades out of an industrial elevator, rumbling towards its terminal floor. Where on earth did they find this lot? This troop? These subtypes inform animals, monsters disguised as human beings. What did they have to do in the first place to all end up in the same cage looking so simian? What on God's earth did we have to do to be locked up with them? Standing stock still, hanging with one arm to the car's railings, life's failing breed. United of one murderous mind in deeds lurking behind eyes that become steadily more crazed. As one fruity salt frothing at the mouth makes a violent lurch in the cage, and with ursine growl declaims, to no one in particular, "Fucketh with me as thou wouldst stick at thine own grave!" Yikes. Maybe he was having a nightmare. As the elevator reaches its destination, the doors open, revealing a cavernous mug-cake tunnel beyond which must be a furnace. Of some kind. If you thought it was hot before, this is on a whole different level. Let me say, at this point, with conviction, because I've got a few, that it's not a game. Not anymore. Not down here, you twazzle wonk. Shit just got mofo real. And if you'd told me all those years ago, when we didn't know each other that well, that my future would be serving time at the bottom of a mine shaft in a godforsaken penal colony, I'd have laughed and said, "Who the fuck are you? Do I even know you? So fuck off." You know? Sometimes it ain't pretty, but it's a common known fact, and there's no denying it. The future. It happens. One way or another. All the time. Literally. There's no getting round it. Still. It's a big day at the penal colony. Inmate FWPC-XXX1221 is being prepped for an interview. He's a lucky son of a bitch. He shot dead the congregation of a small Baptist community in Omaha, shortly before the peace treaty of that name ended what we now call Global War II. It was thought there would not be a Global War II after Global War I. But it seems we, plural, us, as a system, have a predilection, a design flaw, if you like. We seem to get that one wrong again and again. And again, it's a lot of hypocrisy, if you ask me, which no one will, so forgive the turn of phrase or don't. But the meal of it is, now that we have found life, protein intelligence, in multiple quadrants...
No, we haven't.
Yes, we have. Sit down, you motherfucker. And now that the last vestiges of the PPFs...
PPFs...
previously practiced faiths have been stripped away from the remnants of society, should inmate FWPC-XXX1221 still be imprisoned for what was ostensibly a religious crime, now that we have abolished religion? Of course, to me it's pretty damn simple. Inmate FWPC-XXX1221 shot dead 40 people. He's hoping there's no hell. Although, to be fair, this is pretty close. Comes in a hot second, as the other terms term it. But at the time, given the backdrop of the figures coming from the Department of Homeland Security of the numbers of the war dead, let's put it this way, FWPC-XXX1221's kill tally was like a microbe on a pinhead in a tank full of pins. And when I say tank, I mean the armored kind. His legal team said he was traumatized by Global War I. Yeah, who wasn't? Got his judgment commuted from death to serve multiple consecutive life sentences here. Tough break. And that's a whole other story. But FWPC-XXX122... or should we just call him Wally? Wally, short for murdering psycho. That's what we call him. It's actually his name. Anyway, let's just say that this Wally, our Wally, will be only yet another diversion. There's gonna be a riot tonight. Oh yes. I have that on reliable authority. On a terms assurance, I ain't no gulag snag. And tonight, ladies and gentles, drumroll if you please. I'm genuinely excited to announce that after 8 years in this shithole, I'm getting out. Shh. I said shush. Will you shut up? In peace. The thing about a riot is, it's got to look like nothing's going to happen. Then all of a sudden it does. Shh! Alarmingly, out of control, combustible. Of course, if too many people start to have that strange anticipatory gaze in their eyes too early on, then the guards will know it. Pheromone monitoring is pretty standard. We'll all be dosed up, packed off to bed. We won't work for a few days. No one says nothing. We go back to work. The routine continues. The drugs are very effective. Very. They say the interviewer's gonna be a woman. I haven't seen a woman's face in over 8 years. Terms here a lot longer. I can't even remember how they smell. I gotta keep focused. Today's a day like any other. Do your shit, same as usual. Don't be alarming any suspicions.
In orbit above the planet, a small Comcraft, Sigma 457, maintains stasis. Its onboard speaks to the prison guidance system and requests a sequence for landing. It sounds like this.
Prison, I'll say this for it. It keeps you fit. It ain't the food.
Why can't I get no fucking pizza?
Sit down, Term.
A and pill supplements are enough to dampen any appetite. On the way to work, we don't talk to each other much. 15 men in a unit, 7 units in a team, 8 teams in an outfit, 2 outfits in the field at any one time, 4 outfits in total, I mean. Do the math. There are no chains. If you made it to the perimeter door... But why would you want to make it to the perimeter door? Outside, there's practically no atmosphere left. And if you get hit by the sun... Like I say, why would you want to make it to the perimeter door? They say there's only one way out of here. And let's put it this way. You don't remember it. Ever.
Ooh.
Guys, please. And that's not to say that this place is barren. Absolutely not. That's why we're here. Natural resources in abundance. Here. I've been mining the same scene since I got to this hole, and that was 8 years ago. Every term is similar to a degree. Firstly, we're all innocent. Secondly, we all think about escape. We literally dream of escape. Some of us who have committed abominations have those parts of our memory removed, erased, so as not to confound and dispirit the subject with the dark abstractions of the former self, or something like that. It's quite successful, as this doesn't prevent the subject from the condition of remorse, so essential to any form of subsequent rehabilitation. As the subject knows that, and is oft reminded, his former behavior was so bad, so heinous, it had to, for the sake of society and the individual, be erased. There were trees here once. Trees and microorganisms and bugs. All long dead. Of course, no one really gives a crap about that. Unless it can manifest into an argument about the absence of God, or which is better, solitary confinement or work at the rock face. Well, you gotta laugh. Unless it's not funny. However, a while back, inmate FWPC-XXX-3909, let's call him Dewey, for argument's sake. Dewey found what looked kind of like a kind of thing that kind of wanted to be a kind of fish. That was one fugly looking critter. Caused a bit of a stir. An argument. Get it? See, another inmate, FWPC-XXX-2773, he takes me aside one day. He's the reason there's going to be a riot tonight. FWPC-XXX-2773. He says he knows a way out of here, and tonight he's going to give me the tools. Inmate FWPC-XXX. Let's just call him Huey, shall we? Just to save time. He can't really save time, that's her. Never mind. Huey says there's a flood coming. He was real curious about the shape of that fish, what Dewey had found. Dewey said the fish, or whatever kind of thing it was surefire proof that there weren't never no God, and because of that, there ain't no God now neither. You may not like it, but that's why they call it evolution, says Dewey, grinning stupidly. Huey didn't particularly care for Dewey. He cleaved him in half with a pit drill. But that was by the rock face, and accidents happen. Then Huey became all curious about whether I'd seen the fish or just heard about it from Dewey. I told him several of us had seen it, but that it weren't like no fish I'd ever seen. Then he asked me who else had seen it, and I said, what's it worth? And he said, a bona fide way out of here if I tell him the names. I thought about it. I've been thinking about it for months. As soon as I tell him, I'm pretty sure he'll kill me, so saying nothing is a strange kind of life insurance policy. Now, this would all be dust on Mars if it weren't for the fact that Huey has actually escaped. Once. He didn't get very far. But he did actually manage it for a short while, so I'm assuming he has at least got something I haven't thought of that really could be a benefit to a man like me. A desperate criminal, whose crimes against humanity loom so large they had to be erased from my head. Though the knowledge of them still does me pain. In peace. I wait for hours today before catching his eye and giving him the nod. I know from the way his eyes light up that he knows instantaneously what I mean. His eyes dull quickly as he realizes he's betraying too much emotion. The names. The tools. Say you write them down. When you give me half the names, I'll give you one of the tools. When you give me the other half, I'll give you the second tool. When? Whenever you want. leader of the cells. We don't say anything else, but my mind is thinking, what are the tools? I'm sure one will be a map. This place is pretty intricate. I'm sure the other is a passkey or passcode inhibitor, unless one is a gun, but if he had a gun, why wouldn't he use it? I suppose he's just going to bump people off at the rock face, so he may not need one. Can't fill my head with maybes. It's me at the drill.
In an interview room somewhere in the Fort Wells prison complex, Wally, even to other terms, looks distinctly inhuman or alien, a human being in the body of a bull. Years of working at the face, coupled with the unstable mineral ions in constant flux, have given his skin a strange bronze malachite hue. Years without sunlight have driven the eyes deep into sullen pockets of rage, cloaked in a sulking area beneath a brick-like brow. The pupils a speck of black within a yellowish golf ball of menace. Wally is... honestly, he's really scary. Even to a man like me, and I've killed a few people. You should know. I wasn't going to say up front. Actually, I was going to save that for a little later, only... just kind of popped out. Excuse me. I'm sorry. Really, I am. Sorry. I mean, you were going to find out. Anyway, we're talking about Wally, not me. Right now, Wally's being monitored by 5 guards. He sits sharing an unheard joke with them, smoking a cintharette the guard had given him. Waiting.
You wait and see. First they build a penal colony, but they'll betray it here.
Wally, he's got the deepest voice.
I don't think so, Wally.
That's bad news. He's one of the guards. All guards is bad news.
You mark my words. And then more and more people are caught in that trade. And then children. And schools.
This ain't no place for children, Wally.
Where I was born wasn't no place for children either, but it didn't stop me from being born there.
No one can disagree with that. No one's gonna.
You gonna be nice, Wally?
It's more of a request than a question, but comes out as a statement.
Nice.
You ain't gonna cause no trouble.
Same again. Things are hotting up.
Simultaneously, an armored jeep is traveling at speed towards the base. Outside, a scorching desert. Inside the jeep, everyone is wearing visors. There are 4 journalists from the Millennial News Network and the driver from the plant. Vanna, the interviewer, is checking herself out with the aid of a mini vanity mirror. Carl, the sound guy.
For the cons? Seriously?
For you, darling.
For the camera, you idiot,
says Evan, the cameraman.
For 40 million viewers and my mother-in-law, says Prem, the director. Shall we talk about the shoot?
We're all ears, Prem.
Vanna, Evan, and Carl adopt a faux listening tableau.
Cute, cute. Well, I thought we'd start off with a piece to camera, hard-hitting, a walk and talk, sum up what we're doing here, slipping sponsorship, maybe.
I don't know, Prem. That's a bit early in the show, wouldn't you say?
Why are you even asking her? She's gonna do whatever she wants. She always does.
Who's she? The cat's mother? Fuck off, Carl.
Okay, you two. We'll play it by ear. What is it, Carl?
Oh, it's just I hate that expression. It's a stupid fucking expression. Nobody plays anything by ear.
Whenever you need a break, Carl, we'll kick you in the fucking head. Okay.
I had a family once. My wife. My child. In peace, I rarely think of them. It does me harm. The look on their faces when they knew what I'd done. Why couldn't they get rid of that memory too, those bastards? Isn't it strange how you know when someone is watching you, even though you can't see them? I can feel Huey's eyes boring into my back. I turn away from the fire as if to mop my brow, and sure enough, there is Huey standing right behind me. His eyes take me in hungrily. He wants those names, some powerful sort of bad. He's already in the future. I can see him living the dream in his eyes. He's killed us all off one by one, and he's delirious happy at his work at the face. By Christ, he's a maniac. I catch the guard looking at us, looking at each other. So I go over to Huey to make it look natural. And under my breath, I tell him, one of them's a guard. There is consternation in Huey's eyes. Killing us, that's one thing. Killing a guard, with the kind of protection they carry? notwithstanding what they'll do to you afterwards. Before they kill you, that's a whole other deck of cards. You didn't say. I'm saying now. But take the drill, we got an audience. Of course the guard can't hear us. He could barely hear us if he was standing right next to us and he's 5 feet away. The screech of the engine powering the drill searing into the rock face cloaks our conversation. And at the same time makes our ears bleed. Which is okay, because it only hurts when you laugh. And I don't. Okay, so now the jeep carrying the documentary crew is swinging into the compound and is getting consumed behind a descending sheet of steel. The journos decamp from the vehicle, make a big show of shaking off the sand. They find themselves in a gigantic loading bay. They say nothing as they're escorted by two guards to a side elevator. It's going down. The console panel displays over 60 floors. The elevator seems to descend forever.
The first 10 floors are designated for the guards.
Oh, we're getting a guided tour. How charming.
Vanna pretends to flirt with the guard.
Floors 40 and downwards are for the terms.
Oh, yes. You call the prisoners terms over here? Cuts in Carl, in the name of conversation.
Floors 11 to 20 house the internal ventilation shafts. Fort Wells is 100% solar powered.
Yeah, but isn't everything in the world solar powered now? I mean, realistically.
Yeah, but this is one of the first facilities of its kind using this kind of technology, right?
Making it ancient, right?
Floors 21 to 39 we call the buffer, comprises the computer terminal, station, sick bay, interview rooms, the lab, gym, downtime quarters. 49, 63 all have access to the rock face via various tunnels and...
Out of nowhere, and seemingly in the middle of nowhere, the elevator jams to a halt. As casually as she can, Vanna asks what's going on. The guard informs her that now they have to wait as their bodies accommodate a greater density due to gravity.
How long?
A short while, it's automatic.
You know we should be filming this. Can we film in here?
Undesignated area.
The elevator takes off again after a cautionary hum, and they stop at the 30th floor. The journos are met by two more guards who escort them down an interminable passage.
We should be filming this. Can we film here?
I don't see why not. What do you say, Jerry?
Oh, fuck. Fucking fuck.
Yeah, Jerry says okay.
Vanna, are you ready?
I'm always ready.
Evan?
Yep.
Yeah, I'm ready too, asshole.
I heard that, Carl.
And they're off. Vanna walking down the immense passageway, Evan, Prem, and Carl are in front of her. Evan holding the camera, Carl the boom, Prem acting as guide and stop while Evan walks backwards.
End action in 3, 2... Wait a minute, where are the prisoners?
Oh, the terms? Oh, at work. You won't be disturbed.
Fine. End action in 3, 2, 1...
Good evening, I'm Vanna Asarian, and welcome to InScope, your eye on the worlds. Tonight, we are broadcasting from Fort Wells Penitentiary to bring you an exclusive first-time interview with inmate FWPC-XXX-1221, better known to you at home as Wallace Messenger, the infamous ogre of Omaha. 25 years ago this week, Wallace, a veteran of Global War II and himself now in charge of the community arsenal, went on a killing spree with devastating consequences. Not least, some of you might say, for Wallace himself, who promptly found himself tried and sentenced to serve multiple concurrent life terms here at Fort Wells, a place many in law enforcement consider a fate worse than death. But that's the justice system for you folks, and if you voted for it, you've only got yourself to blame. And if you didn't vote for it, you've only got yourself to blame. So, on with tonight's show. A lot of you must be thinking, what was going on inside his head? What could prompt an apparently mild-mannered father of five, a family man, an insurance analyst from the sleepy Midwest, to murder 40 innocent people in cold blood? A lot of you may be wondering what underwear I'm wearing. Well, it's figure-hugging and svelte. Most people would swear you're not wearing anything at all. It's made by Splaytex. Go on, girls. Splay yourselves. You know you want to feel naked. Available from all Legends outsourcing units. As to the first question, No one will ever know what was going on in Wallace's mind, as that portion of his memory has been erased in accordance with governmental guidelines on the standard medical procedure for condemned mass murderers. And here's a little history lesson for you. Memoraid, the byword in cortex removal and cerebral re-enhancement, first implemented its memory rating software over 2,000 years ago under the direction of the new Beijing Convention for Human Rights. All right, first impressions from Fort Wells. It's hot. And now a word from our sponsors.
And cut. That was beautiful, Vanna. I love the way you slipped in the advertising hook early on.
Yeah, I thought better get it out of the way first.
Yeah, we got a lot more time for Wallace now. Sweet. Say, do you really wear splatex? All eyes on Vanna. How could Prem ask her a question like that? And in public.
You know what, Prem? You can be a real cock sometimes.
No one knows what to make of Vanna. She's such an enigma. I make my excuses to the guard. I need to throw up. I make it look convincing. But in truth, it's pretty common down here. The guard hardly flinches, it's so routine. I make my way to the facilities. I have to write down the names. There are no pens here, for obvious reasons. The names are all crap. Not one of them saw Dewey's creature, but a few of them are mean enough to stop Huey in his tracks. Then I have to improvise. I have two choices. Cut myself, write their names in my blood on the toilet paper in here, or use someone else's shit to cast them in it. Now, using someone else's shit while repugnant has its advantages. Firstly, it's someone else's DNA. Fingernails don't leave fingerprints. Secondly, cutting yourself down here brings the considerable risk of infection, where a shit just washes off. It's all shit anyway. Meanwhile, Vanna and her team enter the waiting room where Wallace sits behind the table. He eyes them with a supercilious smile.
Fuck.
Vanna can't help but flinch when she sees him.
So, who do I have to thank for giving the day off work?
There's that deep voice again. He's a fucking maniac, Wally. He stares at Vanna. Stepping in front of Vanna, Prem answers.
That would be me.
He stands as close to Wally as the table will physically allow. That's called bravery, my friends. And how not to bait a serial murderer.
Well, thank you.
Wally's got his target now. The shadow, that is his voice, continues.
Say, I got a question. Why'd you come out all this way? Obviously, I can't tell you what I done on account of having that part of my brain taken out. But I don't mean that so much as, couldn't you done a satellite link up?
Yeah, we could have.
Prem agrees, wondering where this is going. I could tell him.
We could have done that, but I prefer the personal approach. And since our show calls itself the Eye on the Woods, we really need to be here in person to meet you. You know, that personal approach. Person to person.
Prem, while he's not a kitten, stop talking to him like that. Honestly, you're going to get yourself murdered. Shut up. Get out quickly, while you've got the chance. Alas, Prem is not sure of a premonition, and he also can't hear me. He continues blithely, smilingly.
But also the sight of an attractive woman like Vanna rubbing up next to all you convicted criminals has a kind of sexy, forbidden element that's a really big hit with our demographic.
And you weren't afraid to come all this way?
While his voice rises. Holy fuck. Tsunami alert.
Of what? It's a prison, not a war zone, with all due respect. And you've got five guys watching your every book.
Before he can complete the sentence, Wally has jumped onto the table, bounced off it, and jumped onto Prem, containing him in a bear hug. He roars with glee. Vanna screams.
Now easy does it, Wally. You said he was gonna be nice.
No, you asked me and I didn't say nothing. Now I'm gonna tell you how it's gonna be.
No one argues with Wally and lives.
Are we filming this?
While Prem asks the question innocently enough, he takes out a small spray can from his pocket and ineffectively tries to spray it in Wally's face.
Mint?
It's not mace?
Wally looks at him, pulls out another canister from Prem's other pocket, and promptly sprays it in his face. Wally smacks Prem with such ferocity that he's unconscious before he hits the floor.
Wielding the mace with one hand and grabbing Banner with the other, Wally pulls her in front of him.
Now things got a lot more interesting, wouldn't you say?
I roll up the toilet paper with all the shit names back on its spoke, waiting to be unfurled. Some of the names have been a bit smudged. It's all right, don't worry about it. It's a shit list. I look at it from time to time as I air wash for a long, long time. Cleanliness is next to godliness, which is now next to nothing, but being hygienic does seem to keep you alive a little longer. What for? Revenge. Revenge. Revenge is mine, revenge is sweet. Revenge whispers softly to me in my sleep. Revenge for all the days of hands and tongues and infernal eyes on wanted men who ate my soul. Who swallowed me whole? If only I knew. But though blind in the eye of the night, I will find you and pack you off to heaven via Armageddon. Amen. Oh, the oldies are the best. Out of the can, into the pariah, I give Huey the nod so casually you'd miss it if you weren't looking for it, but he's looking for it. A while passes and Huey throws up and makes his excuses. When he returns later, he has a glint in his eye and he smells of shit. On the way up from the shaft, you'd never know there was going to be a riot tonight. The men all look exhausted. They're pretty good at playing their parts. There's quite a few of them must know about tonight. Only Huey can't keep his eyes off me. I return the stare and find he looks away. As we arrive at the annex, we reach our moment. We line up at our cells and Huey slips me. Would you believe, of all things, a knife? Where he got it, God knows. But it's pretty profoundly useless in a place like this. Well, I look at it and say, what the fuck am I supposed to do with this? He only says, do you want the second tool? I nod. If the first tool was useless, the second tool was surprising and useless. Huey places a small yellow capsule in my hand. Not really what I'd imagine would be a useful tool for escape. He only says, join me at the baths. I'm beginning to feel double-crossed. This ain't a way out of here. Oh, but it is. We're parted into our respective cells. I suppose now all I have to do is wait for the riot. Time to let off a bit of steam.
Welcome, Terran. What game would you like to play?
Turkish Delight.
Turkish Delight loaded.
We're now clad in monastic robes as we reach a steam room. That's the great thing about virtual comm, especially if the other terms are playing the same comm. It's so realistic. We pass several robed, hooded, and towel-clad men sitting around a steaming Turkish bath. We walk towards one of the hooded figures. He removes his hood ever so slightly to reveal.
Well, bless my soul.
What's the knife for, Huey?
Well, that bit to slit your wrist.
We can't work out if he's joking or not. And if I choose not to do that?
Well, then you got that little yellow capsule. It's cyanide a lot quicker and substantially less painful.
We had a deal.
Yeah, you gave me names, I'll give you two tools to escape, and I gave you two tools of escape. There's only one way out of here, and you know it. I just supplied you with two exits.
We look at him a long time and then say, the names are all shit, Huey. I lied. And then real casually says,
and you better hope you use one of them tools tonight, or by Christ, I'll take you tomorrow. I'm a man of my word.
When's the riot?
Oh, there ain't gonna be no riot. Not unless it's the one going off inside your head right now. God be with you.
Who knows how many men I've killed? Is one more gonna make a blind bit of difference? It might, but it's rhetorical. If there's more than a slight chance that my attempt to break out of prison tonight is anything but a complete success, and there's more than a slight chance, then Huey needs to be dead already. Always go for the arms. It's a surefire bet. That's why Huey sat up against the wall. He's not stupid. We look down and kick his legs away. So Huey slips. As he does so, we scramble for his arms and hold them in a lock behind his head. In the center of the room is the furnace, the hot coals,
We frog march Huey to the furnace. We thrust him face forward onto the coals and screams in agony until his body becomes lifeless and seethes with heat.
Do you want to exit the game?
Yes, yes, I want to fucking exit the game.
So much sweat. Honestly, from a simulation. But I know that Huey's in his cell, dead, helmet on. His arms wrapped behind his back, not a scratch on him. Barring a few broken ribs and a broken nose when I threw him into those virtual coals. And his face would have smacked against his own comm helmet.
Gotta move quickly. Won't be long till Huey's body loses heat and the thermal alarm in his cell will sound.
Could have been luck killing him in the hammam. Ha! That should jack up his temperature for a while.
Give me a bit more time. So, the only way there's gonna be a riot tonight is if I start one. I look at the pill and the knife. A long time. Hesitating slightly. I slip my wrists. I confess I do feel a chill go through my body. Then I address the closed circuit.
In peace. I've hurt myself. I need assistance.
Please place your hands above your head.
I'm afraid I can't do that.
I outstretch my arms and present my slashed wrist to the camera.
Fucking Christ, how'd he do that to himself?
Is he covered in blood?
What do you think that is? Eggplant, get a fucking guard out now!
The official voice tries to remain calm.
Terminal C 1998-876. Please remain still in your cell while we locate assistance.
I need to sit against something, is that okay?
Yeah, knock yourself out.
I pretend to stumble forward. Embracing myself, I take out the monitor with my head. It hurts, but they can't see me now. Terms don't usually resort to breaking the comm. If you do, it's supposed to be 2 years without privs. This place feels more like 3 years to 4 years. You might as well be dead. Must have looked convincing. I hear one of their voices.
Hey, this fucking term crashed to his own comm!
When the guard arrives, I'm ready for him. He peers into the cell, he can't see much. He calls to me to move away from the door. This I do. As the door opens, I jump upward and upend the bed so it's standing sideways and shoot it out of the cell door like a missile. Ah! The guard was totally not expecting that. The bed smacks him straight in the shins and sends him reeling ass first to the ground. He lets off a few rounds by accident. That'll wake the neighbors. The doors close only so far as the bed will allow. I leap on top of him. He doesn't stand a chance. I rip off his face mask. Don't do anything stupid, Term. Too late. I thrust the pill in his face. Now I could kill you right now, you motherfucker. Or you could help me. Now what would you rather do? I want to help. Oh, good. Give me a sidearm. As soon as he does, I thrust him in his face, pull him to his feet, and thrust him back into the cell. Now, on your comm, do it. Tell him you had to shoot me. It's regrettable. You'll be requiring a D-team.
Section control? Yeah, what the fuck is going on down there, Stevens?
It's okay, I mouth, training the gun on his head.
It's okay, but I had to shoot him. It's a bit of a mess. It just got out of hand. I'll need a D-team down here. Are you okay, Stevens?
Yeah, I'm fine.
How many is that now, Stevens? Your regular Billy the Kid. What is that, 16? Going on 17?
Yeah, shut up about that.
He looks at me nervously. No hurry, I mouth.
No hurry.
And with that, I clock him round the head with a gun. Good night, Stevens. It would have been a shame to use the cyanide capsule, especially if I don't have to, and on someone else. I strip him and slip into his suit. Helmet. And mask. I check the time, but the card mask isn't the clearest. Can't quite make it out. I'll ask someone later. Anyway, it's not the time, it's what you do with it. I step out of the cell for the last time. I fire a few random shots at cameras, power supplies, a few cell doors. Use the smoking gun to sear up my wounds. Ah! A few terms come to the doors of their cells. They think I'm a guard. Too funny.
What's going on?
What's going on? What's going on?
My voice synthesizer kicks in. Even I don't recognize it.
I'd say it was a riot, boys.
The stares on their faces makes me laugh. And then far off, like a giant awaking from an eon of sleep. Surely that's not for me. Someone else must be planning their own little entertainment tonight. Even better, remember, don't run. Guards don't run. As I reach the far end, the security pass on my glove opens the section door. On the inside of that is the emergency alarm. It'll release all the terms from their cells on this level, but it'll contain them in this section. That's good, because I'll be on the other side of the divide, dressed like this if they got the chance. They'd tear me apart. I light one of the guard's cigarettes under an absolutely no smoking sign, take a drag, and stick the lit end under one of the electron consoles. A slow burn. But every little bit helps. Soon, I can't tell how long exactly, it'll blow the fuse that holds the doors that contain this section. I'll be long gone by then. I find myself in another identical corridor. Remember, don't run. I turn to the elevator, must get to the bottom. The only way out of here is through the mine, one of the pipes that draws oil to the surface. Through there, never monitored, no one would be crazy enough. What is it with elevators?
Going up.
I didn't press any buttons, damn it. So someone may have called the elevator from above. Uh-oh. Better prepare for a reception committee. No one. Thank God. And forgive me. In peace.
Arrive, floor 30, Central Annex. Please wait a short time on this level if you've come from levels 45 or lower for your body temperature to acclimatize before proceeding to the surface.
Yeah, fuck that. I round a corridor and walk past the interview room. No one sees me at first. Five guards, their weapons out, all tracing them on Wally. Two men out on the floor, presumably dead. One civilian standing with his face to the wall, his arms over his head. I don't see any of them really, it's more of a blur. In Wally's arms and being held by the throat. A woman. And she's crying. Slowly they all see me. I stare at them, not knowing what to do. I make a decision. It seems to take forever, but I know it's momentary. I move on. It's amazing how quick thought actually is. I've hardly walked two steps and my brain has been chattering away to me. That must have been the interviewer. A woman.
A woman.
Something inside wants to go back.
Go back.
But something else questions why.
Why?
For a woman.
For a woman.
Because she's in peril.
Because she's in peril.
Fuck it all to hell, you're in peril. But abandoning a woman. But would you be waiting in for the right reasons? What are the right reasons? Anyway, whose side would you be on? Can it help?
I don't know.
I stop and for some reason I find myself turning around. I don't know what I'm gonna do, but I better think of something pretty damn quick. Again, I'm standing in front of the interview room. Nothing much has changed as far as I can make out. What's the last thing in the world a guard would do? I take a few steps back, as if I'm about to convert a football. And then I take a running leap, and as I jump, I tuck my legs under my stomach as much as the suit will allow, and I hurtle myself headfirst through the glass.
Anybody got a shot?
Fuck!
I don't got a shot! I don't got a shot!
Goes in the I way. Roll onto the goes floor and the get way. Up, advancing on Wally.
Hey, Wally, don't do anything.
Who, along with everyone else
Wally.
In the room, is in a state of
Wally,
shock.
Don't do anything fucking stupid.
And shedding off shards of glass.
One more move, and I'll rip a little throat out.
With my back to the other guards, I lower my mask and reveal my face. A moment of suspended disbelief gives way and Wally laughs and the woman starts screaming in horror.
Release the girl immediately!
I say, but I wink at him at the same time. Now Wally's guard is down, which it shouldn't be. I'd sooner trust a guard than a fellow term, but maybe the fact that I'm dressed as one but am obviously another has confused Wally's highly tuned sense of us and them. I return his smile and I knock the woman unconscious with my backhand that sends her flailing out of his grip, careening into the wall. She'll be out for a while. This is also good.
Wally!
As Wally starts to frown,
Wally.
I withdraw my weapon and blow him away. It's that simple.
Shit.
I replace my mask and turn around to the other stunned guards.
Are you guys okay?
As they rise, they collectively mumble something to the affirmative.
Fuck me.
I notice one of the men on the floor. He seems familiar to me. Do I know him? Have we met before? Did we work together? Was I in journalism? I ask the guards.
Who needs medical attention?
One of them gets on the comm.
Yeah, this is Koshi. We're gonna need a D-team down here while his interview just got ugly.
I was gonna die.
We're now walking
there.
Down a corridor, me and five other guards. The woman's in one of their arms. Another reporter is walking in front of us looking shell-shocked.
Yeah, nice
this
work, buddy.
This wasn't exactly how I saw my escape panning out. Strolling down the passageway with five guards. But it could be worse. I could be their prisoner. We make it to another elevator. Their captain turns to me.
You got somewhere to go? Stevens! I'm supposed to be getting off before sunlight.
I don't know what that means. Still, it seems to make sense to the guards.
Graveyard shift, ain't it a bitch?
Shut up, Groves. No one asked you. So, Stevens, would you and Cortez mind escorting the journos to the sickbay?
I pause. Maybe a fraction too long.
Sure. Oh, you don't mind, do you? Sure, that's okay. You remember the way? You know where to go?
Truth is, this place is a maze. I don't know how to get to sickbay without an escort.
I'm sure Cortez can tell me.
Guards laugh. Just me, the journos, and Cortez. And then one of them says,
No, I'm coming too. I'm gonna pass the canteen and send a mail.
This one smells awful and sniffs a lot.
All right, Stevens, Cortez, and McGaffey.
Inside the elevator, Cortez pushes the button for the 45th floor. I'm pretty amazed. Who knew sickbay was on my floor? All these years. Then he pushes the button for the 23rd floor.
Just kidding.
They're still sharing my joke about being lost. But that's the problem right there when you fuck around. You press the button for the 45th floor, my floor, and even though it was a joke, the elevator, like all elevators since time began, is going to obey its first command. They never worked out an elevator which comprised the facility, like any household calculator, of being able to erase your first command. No, when you press a button on an elevator, there is no cancel button. 4,000 plus years of civilization, no fucking cancel buttons on the elevators. Regardless of whether you're gonna fuck around or not, if you press the button, the elevator, you know, is gonna take you to that floor. There is no going back. This is a shame, since I only escaped from that floor less than half an hour ago. There are two things that are increasingly worrying and problematic. One is that we will enter a full-scale riot, the one I started by lighting an incendiary under the fuse consoles, and I'm dressed as a guard. Two, the alarmingly possible fact that we will bump into the real Stevens on the way, and I'm dressed as a guard, called Stevens.
Then McGaffey hits the button for the 47th floor. What do you do that for, you moron? Couldn't agree more. Fuck, am I ever gonna get out of here?
Like I said, I wanna check by the canteen and send a mail.
You wanna snort crack in the term wreck up more like?
No, I don't. Fuck you, Cortez.
Fuck you, McGaffey.
Hey, I'm not the fuckman who pressed the 45th floor, asswipe.
Asswipe? Who are you calling an asswipe?
You fucking cunt. Hey,
do you hear the one about your mama going to the doctors?
No, I didn't, because my mama don't need to see no medic.
No, but she went for you, man. And your mama says, hey, doc, my son, he ain't got no nose. And the doc replies, well, how does your son smell? And your mama replied, love fucking stink. He's been gone for 5 years. I still can't get the stink out of my house.
That's not funny, Cortez. Man, that's not funny. You never know when to stop, and I got a condition.
No, you never know when to stop because of your condition.
Fuck you, Cortez.
Fuck you, McGaffey.
Fuck you, Cortez.
By the time we hit the 44th floor, we can smell smoke. In a place like this, that can only mean one thing. Cortez drops the woman to the floor of the elevator. He, McGaffey, and I raise our weapons.
Hi, I'm Carl from the Millennial News Network. What should I do?
Shut the fuck up.
When the doors open, a chair is launched through it and smacks McGaffey squarely on the chin.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.